we are here, all of us, to celebrate a four-day festival called as Diwali. Diwali, it comes from the word Deepali, Deepali in Sanskrit. The word Deepa means the light, and Ali means the line, the rose. Now, there are many things that have happened during these 4 days, and that's how it is celebrated with such a great enthusiasm. The first thing is the day of the Lakshmi's birth. That is the 13th day of the moon, Teras they call it. It's the real day when Lakshmi was born out of the sea. That's why she's called as Miriam or Mariam. Word Mari or Marine also comes from the word sea. So she's born out of the sea. She's created out of the sea. And the wealth of the sea so far, thank God, human beings have not yet exploited. But they may one day start doing that also. And a lot of wealth is still there. So when people start getting worried about exhausting the Mother Earth, you must know that sea is much more than the earth is. So nothing is exhausted. Since there's such a lot reserved for you, and one should not worry, thank you. As to the supply of wealth that can come from the sea. Now this Lakshmi is the goddess who stands on the lotus. She represents all the well-being, the wealth, the the glory of wealth, the decoration of wealth, whichever is auspicious. Whatever is not auspicious is not wealth, according to Sahaja Yoga or according to any scripture. It is not wealth at all. So she is a lady who stands on a lotus, showing that a person who has got wealth has to be a person who doesn't assert his pressures on people, who doesn't push people around, who doesn't pressurize. And then she's a lady, she's a mother. So wealth is the first opening to our seeking. But when you start seeking the wealth, you realize that the superficial wealth that you are seeking is not sufficient, is not going to give you complete joy. So you start seeking the deeper wealth. As I said, that on the Mother Earth you have exploited all that is possible, still there deep down in the sea, lot of wealth still there. So then the seeking moves towards the deeper seeking. So the same Lakshmi becomes Mahalakshmi. When you start expanding yourself to higher and deeper valuable things, then this Lakshmi doesn't lure you much. She is just there for your glory, but not for your satisfaction. The wealth is there for distribution. You enjoy the, there's no word for daan, I think. Generosity. Oh, generosity. But generosity is different. But what I'm saying, generous funds. it's a fondness, you see, that you should be generous.
No.
Is a very great. Happiness and joy that you feel, that is the greatest when you are generous, when you give away. That's a fondness, that's a kind of a human expression of one's own being, that you want to be generous. And this generosity only can come when Mahalakshmi principle is born in you. But at Lakshmi principle also, she stands like this. Her hand is like this one, as giving. The another is like this. So miserliness is not a sign of wealth. I mean, if you are miserly, that means you are not wealthy. If you are really wealthy, why will you be miserly? A simple quick question is there. That means if you are really wealthy, you will just give away. If you cannot give away, then you are poor. You are a beggar. You are still hankering after that. That means you are still a beggar. You are hankering for it. So this left hand she is giving all the time. And with the right hand she protects people. She gives protection to people. The wealth must give protection to people in the way it must look after the well-being of others, not your own self-indulgence. Like having all the best things to yourself while others are starving. That's not a sign of a wealthy man. A wealthy man is a person who knows that unless and until he shares his things with others, he is not going to be happy ultimately. For the time being, he may be. People live with imbalances, they live with wrong ideas. But ultimately they have to correct it. If they do not correct this, there are problems. Then there's upheaval, lots of changes come in, people start seeing that, oh, this doesn't work out, that doesn't work out. The children run away from the houses, the family goes into problems, all sorts of things happen. And then they realize, this is the reason, I've been very miserly, I've not been generous, I've not been using money for the sake of others. Now, after coming to Sahaja Yoga, you become a divine person. Definitely you become divine. You are now a divine personality. You are not a human personality. So you have to give up all that is human within you. Then only you will be fully divine. But it's very difficult. That's the problem is, that it is very difficult to really accept that you are divine and that you have to take divine policies and divine attitudes and divine temperament. Now, the divine temperament is generous. It is not bothered as to what happens next. It's not bothered because it is connected with the source. If you give one, you will get 100. It is sure about it. And to a divine person, worldly things have no meaning if they cannot give pleasures to others. A person who is very self-indulgent, always bothered about himself, is not a divine person at all. In no way he is divine. It's very common, it's human. Everybody does that. Everybody is self-preserving. But after Sahaja Yoga, you do not start all this nonsense again. You give it up. And who looks after you? Who looks after your self-preservation? Is God Almighty. You are now completely dedicated to Him and He looks after you. You don't have to worry as to how to look after yourself, how to do this, how to do that. It is His work. The more you go on worrying about yourself, the worse it will be. The moment you give it up, it is looked after. Many Sahaja Yogis must have experienced in their lifetime that when they try to give it up, they get all the help from God. But whenever they try to assert and worry about their well-being and things like that, then there is a problem. You don't know from where the help comes. We have had so many examples, so many so-called miracles, where people wanted to do something and suddenly they got the money from somewhere they least expected. So, for a divine person, the attitude should be of giving and of protection. Protect. Now we are very good at protecting our bhoots and protecting others who are bhoots. You see, the sympathies always go to bhoots because they have a way of creating a sympathetic attitude in your heart. So you start looking after that person because that person looks so much miserable, you see. You have to protect the saints. You have to protect the principle of God, the divinity in others, and not the bhoots. You are not here to care for all the bhoots of the world. So the idea of Lakshmi must be understood in a proper way. In Sahaja Yoga, it's a very different thing from all other people know about, like charity. Like people say now, we must have be charitable, start a charitable organization, in that you look after this kind of people, that kind of people. We are not bothered. You are not, that's not you are given realization for, to look after every sort of a person. You are here to look after all the saints and all born realized children. And you are not to bother about people who do not matter to God and Divine. When they come to realization, if they get realization, if they become saints, all right. But you don't worry about every Dick, Tom and Harry on the street. Oh, mother, he's so miserable and this and that. So the charity must be understood in a divine light. And the divine light will give you discretion to understand whom to be charitable. You have to be charitable to your brothers and sisters. You have to be kind to them. Now you will say, what about worrying about mother, people who are starving, who are this? That's not your heading. Why should you do their jobs? We are all good at doing others' jobs. For example, you are driving in the car. Oh, look at this. There should have been this properly done, that they should have done properly. But that's not your job. Why should you waste your energy in finding out what the others should have done it? You should do what you have to do. And don't waste your energy in these things. See, all these charitable institutions, I have seen those people who work there are very difficult for realization. This is the proof of the pudding. Because to whom to do the charity? If there is no other person, you do not do charity to anyone. I mean, sitting down here, I can do charities to people so-called, which are not charities, they are part and parcel of my being. I just do it because they are part and parcel of my being. I don't have to go all out to sacrifice something to do charity. Because that's nothing but ego pampering and ego-oriented. Oh, I have helped this man. And how dare he say such a thing? So this is one quality of the Divine. One should know that it is generous. It is generous to a fault. To a fault. It is generous because it is generous. It is not bothered. It doesn't reason out itself, why should I be generous? It is generous because it is, because it's the whim, it's the fondness. The fondness of generosity is such as you have fondness, say, people have fondness to drink, for example, let's see. That's not fondness, it's a habit, I think. But you can say some fondness people have. What kind of a fondness you have without forming a habit, I don't know. Because you always have a habit and then the fondness. But supposing you just have a fondness. For example, you are fond of, say, good food, let us take it. Now, if you have fondness of good food, then you will just do it because you are fond of it. Now somebody says, why are you fond of good food? I said, I am just fond, finished. Who are you to ask me such a question? If somebody is fond of generosity, he will be generous whether you like it or not. And it is sometimes to a reasonable man may look to be a bit too much. The greatest generosity a human being can do is to forgive. I mean, it's not generosity to others, but to yourself. If you forgive others, you are generous to yourself. First of all, be generous to yourself. That is, you forgive everybody else. If you forgive everybody else, then you are not tortured by them. You spare yourself from their tortures. This is a generosity towards yourself. Towards yourself, the greatest generosity is that you do not bear any malice or bitterness about anyone, but clear-cut ideas that he's like this and he's like this. Just a clear-cut idea, but no reaction out of it. Somebody is a man, say he's bhutish. All right, he's a bhutish fellow, we know he's a bhutish, keep yourself in bandhan, but don't have a reaction out of it. Then you have really forgiven everyone. Forgiveness gives you a big kavacha, is a big bandhan, is a gift protection. We can say a shield from all kinds of evil that others can put on you. Just forgive them. And then you see what happens to them. You just try this trick. Just forgive and see what happens to others who try to torture you. Of course, Divine never wants to torture anyone. That is definite. It never wants to torture. It is extremely generous. It likes to forgive, it enjoys its forgiveness. It really enjoys. Generosity is to be enjoyed in the same way forgiveness is to be enjoyed. It's very enjoyable. When you forgive others, it's the most enjoyable thing is that you see the place. You become the witness. So the Mahalakshmi Tattva, when it develops into you, first of all you have to forgive if somebody has borrowed money from you, has not returned. Doesn't matter. People, it's difficult for people to forgive people who borrow money and don't give. And beyond that is also another problem, that if you lend some money to somebody, then run away from that person. Because even to give is easier, but take is even worse. A person who takes money from you will never forgive you all your life, because you have lent money to him. So one has to understand that when you become divine, you just give. This is Mahalakshmi Tattva. Mahalakshmi Tattva is that you give. Don't worry about what is the result, how others react to it, what happens to it, what is the ultimate result and what you achieve out of it and how the person has taken. Just give. That is Mahalakshmi Tattva. But when I say give, also we must use discretion. That is the part we always forget. You see, Sahaja Yoga must teach you discretion. That is the divine thing. Divine is the most discreet thing. Now, when I say give, I know people will just start running on the street, finding out somebody where you can give something. You don't have to run about to find out somebody that you should give something to someone. No need. It's just flowing. It's just flowing. Wherever the chance is, just try to give material things, something kind words, sweetness, comfort. But never give one thing, which I sometimes do by mistake. Never give advice. That's a very dangerous thing. You can give bandhan, you can beat the person at his back with shoes, but never give an advice in words. That is one of the principles of Sahaja Yoga for the time being. Because giving advice, you know what it means. You may have a boxed nose or something. It's a very dangerous thing. So best is, on that part, I would say, as the advice is concerned, you have so many ways and methods of handling a situation. So better not speak about it, just handle it in complete silence. Whatever you have to do about a person, just handle him without talking to that. The more you try to convince the person, the worse he will get, because they are not divine. They haven't reached that divinity. It's a special. They are special type of people, you see, who cannot become divine, and you do not break your necks with them. Also, don't give advice to other Sahaja Yogis. Everybody at this stage thinks that they are all, they know all about Sahaja Yoga. It's all right, good idea. Very good idea. But never try to tell them what they should do, what is good for them, unless and until they come and ask. Now, this Mahalakshmi Tattva, when it grows into collectivity, what happens? That you learn that you have to just give and you don't worry about the receiving. As Krishna has said, karmanyeva adhikaraste paleshu ma kadachi. Our job is to do the karmas and we are not to worry about the phala. Just try to give whatever is possible to everyone, vibrations, realization. I know it is wasted so many times. You give realization, it is waste. It's like, you see, the seeds that are thrown on the rocks. Yes, I know, it is. So many times I've wasted thousands of them. But doesn't matter, you give them. It is not you are giving them for their sake, but for your sake. It is for your satisfaction you are doing it. For your fondness you are doing it. So just try to give realization to everyone, anyone who asks for it. But as Christ has rightly said, that don't throw pearls before the swine. I mean, I shouldn't use this word today on such an auspicious day, but doesn't matter. So, this he has said it. Now, this kind of people, who are they? They are the people who don't discern it. So, there is no need to give realization to every person you come across, talk to everyone. Gradually, you will meet such people who will ask for Sahaja Yoga, for realization, and give it to them. Gradually, those pigs, or what you call them, whatever Christ has called them, they will evolve, I'm sure, one day, and they'll come to. So, let us try on the first level, where there are genuine seekers of a high level. And you'll be amazed how they are sorted. You see, there isn't much space in the kingdom of God, to be very frank. And we should not worry if we don't have many people over there. For us, it is a responsibility. We must have all the population of this world going up there. It's a wrong idea. That's not needed at all. See, we should not crowd them there. Here only we can't sit all of us, you see. We'll have to have a bigger place. So, we should not bother so much as to the quantity, that the quantity is not much. Of course, we should try our level best to pass the message, because they should not say that we didn't get the message. To pass the message is all right. But we need not in any way force people or ask them to come to Sahaja Yoga or make them Sahaja Yogis. It's a difficult thing. The more you will try, the worse they will be. They'll be so troublesome that it's going to be an impossible task. So, in your generosity, you must have discretion, how far to go with people, how far to work it out. This is the Mahalakshmi Tattva which comes to you as a result of Sri Ganesha, who blesses you with wisdom as to how to be generous with others. Where to give, what to give, the discretion starts working. You don't have to think about it, it just works out. It just works out. Discretion in Sahaja Yoga doesn't mean at all thinking or rationally coming to a conclusion, but it means that it just works out that way, in the sense that you feel it in your vibratory awareness. Once such a discretion is developed, you'll be amazed that those who are not to enter into the kingdom of God will just shun you. Will not come close to it. And is better for us, less headache. See? Because they think that we need them, while they don't know, they need realization, not we. We have got our realization. So this is about generosity today, I wanted to tell you, about being generous to Sahaja Yogis. Now, I'm not going to tell you that you go on giving presents to Sahaja Yogis and all that, because as you know that these material things have no value except they have symbolic value. And symbolically, if you work for them, and if symbolically if you try to express yourself, it is going to work out much better than in material way that it should be so expensive, it should be so much, that's not good. Symbolically, you should work out material gifts and things among yourselves. But the main thing one should understand, that collectivity will only grow when you do not by any of your attitude or behavior suggest that others are lower than you or others are higher than you. For example, you see something straight. You see quite far away. I see much more than what you can see. It's a fact, you know that. But I don't tell. I just say, I don't know, maybe try this, try that. I keep quiet. I just try to play about. So I say, all right, let's see, I'll consult you, I'll consult him, everybody I'll consult, you see, all right, try this, and or I do all these tricks, you see. Because I don't want you to feel that mother knows everything, so why should I know? First of all, you can say that. Or you may say that mother knows so much and I know nothing, I can never reach. So what you have to do is to make another person see as much as you see. How will you do that? By being with him all the time, by being in such a relationship that the other doesn't feel the oppression of that personality, as if that person, oh, he's so great, he knows so many things, and he is so evolved, what are we? We are nothing. When if you develop such an attitude towards a person, then the other person can also develop another attitude, just the other way round. That he'll oppose such a person, he'll stand out, he'll be angry all the time, at the slightest pretext, he'll be off and he'll feel hurt and he'll be miserable. All these things can come up. So it is not going to help you, not the other person. But to tell another person, if you want to raise that person higher, the best thing is to make him your friend, your dearest person, and let him see as much as you can see together, then the vision is broader. It's not that one person sees something more and others do not see, and the other person, the person who can see, thinks no end of himself. You should behave in such a manner as if you don't know anything. It's better. You should see me, how I behave. I don't tell you anything. I just say, all right, why? Whatever you think proper, do it. Then you come round, you say, mother, but it happened like this, and you had told us this way. So I said, I had told you, all right. But I didn't say, all right, this is going to happen, but it happens. So it's better that you should also develop that kind of an attitude that all of us have to move together. There's nobody who can just pull out oneself ahead. We all have to go together, even me. Even if I may be anything, what does it matter? What does it matter? If God is great, so what? He may be great in his own place. But what do we gain out of him is the point, that his greatness should be seen through us if we can not move up to that point. What's the use of his greatness? It's better that he's away. He's too great for us. So he has to come down. He has to come down to this level to make everybody feel that they are part and parcel of his own ignorance. He may be the most knowledgeable person, so what? You have to take the cover of the ignorance upon yourself and go on slowly exposing yourself. In the same way, if you can do it with other Sahaja Yogis, then only you could be good leaders. And you have been really generous with the full discretion. So today's day is, as I told you, the 13th day is the goddess. Dhanteras it is called as, that is the day of the Graha Lakshmi. She came as Graha Lakshmi. In the household, the lady is the one who is the symbol of that Lakshmi to begin with. Because she's the one who looks after your food, looks after your comfort, she protects you, she nourishes you, she gives you joy. And the women who cannot do that are not Graha Lakshmis. They are not the housewife, is a very poor word for that. They are the Graha Lakshmis, means they are the goddesses of the family. So, the other day we were in America, I told the girls, I said, let us meet and what we can do. It's all right, I'm the mother, you can give me food if you want. I don't mind. Give the boys first and then the girls should eat. And one of them got very angry with me. She said, Mother, what is this? They are dominating us. Actually, if somebody eats before or later, what is the domination? I mean, in any case, you are going to eat before or after. I don't understand the portion of domination. But, see, you are privileged. You are privileged that you can look after so many people, you see. What is so wrong in it? You see, the whole atmosphere is so funny. That if the men eat first, then women should feel that we are put down. It's absurd. Because it's a privilege. You are like a mother. You are the person who has to look after them. You have to feed them. It's a privilege that a Graha Lakshmi should do that, look after everybody, give them food to eat and treat them just like their proteges, you can say, something like that. It's such a privilege, is a sign of complete maturity. Even little girls you have seen, if they are brought up properly, you see, otherwise they can be horrified. But normally little girls are very generous, more generous than men are. And they are very, you see, always try to make you very happy. They have great sense. If somebody is sitting down, they'll come and give you food and look after you. And I mean, I have seen my all three grandchildren and daughters do that. You see, even once a washerwoman came in the house, they said, you must sit on the sofa. They said, but no, I can't sit on the sofa. No, you must sit on the sofa. Said. They opened the fan for her and they brought all the things that were in the kitchen for her to eat. Now, and they brought some plate and this and that. And the elder one, she told me, I told her, what do you want to be? She said, I can only be a nurse or a air hostess. I said, why? Air hostess and nurse, why? These are the only two professions where one can give, isn't it, food? Otherwise this, I mean, it's a privilege. Other professions you can't do this great job, this noble job, you see, this of giving food. So that's why I want to be either the nurse or the air hostess. And they play, I have seen these girls play. Now I am the air hostess, now you must eat this. they bring food in small little things, you see, they make their own things. Now I'm their hostess and they bring it. Now there may not be any food in it, see, maybe some stones they have put or whatever. You must eat, you must look after yourself, you're thinning down, you better, like that, you see, so sweet. And then they'll bring some pillows, now you must lie down. Like air hostesses they're working, you see. Are you feeling cold? Would like to have a blanket or something? I said, what game is this? Then we are air hostesses. It's such a privilege, an innocent privilege. And that's what, if we develop this nonsense of a right that we are higher, they are lower, all this nonsense will go away. Who is higher and lower? See, like some here are here and some are here. Are they higher or lower? You can't do without this or this. It is an absurd idea that have come into our heads that we are higher, lower. So, a Graha Lakshmi is the one who has to be a noble woman, has to be an example in the family. Like a housewife herself is a drunkard, marries 10 times. What will happen to her children? Just think of it, such a woman. A woman who has no sense of chastity, no sense of auspiciousness, no sense of protection for them. What can she talk? Who is she? What does it matter? I mean, what comfort can anybody give to a housewife? She is the one who is the source of comfort. What comfort can you give her? To her, the greatest comfort is that you eat your food properly, you sleep well, you keep well. That is the greatest comfort. So this is what one has to know, that a Grahalakshmi is the woman in the family. She is the Grahalakshmi. But the man should not be a wolf also. A Grahalakshmi cannot marry a wolf, you must understand. If the man is a wolf, then he doesn't deserve to have a Grahalakshmi, but he can have a she-wolf as his wife. That's a good idea. Then they can fight, quarrel, have all kinds of divorces. But it's the responsibility of the Grahalakshmi to begin with, I must say. To keep the balance, it is her duty. It is not the duty of the other people in the family. It is she who keeps. She doesn't give up at any cost. Of course, if he's a wolf, all right, he can go to the forest. She's not bothered. But the men must understand, the more you start respecting the housewife, the Grahalakshmi is in the family, the more there is respect, the more there will be settling of these women in their proper places, becoming proud of their houses and families and their own setup that they have put in. They'll feel they have a meaning and the whole society will change. But if the men run after dirty women and cheap and street women, then the same housewives can take to that. So that is very important, that they must be respected because they are Grahalakshmi. That is one thing. Second thing is, they are also Rajalakshmi. Rajalakshmis are the goddesses who are looking after the country. Like England has a Rajalakshmi. Now, we can say the princess now is a Rajalakshmi. She's a woman with dignity, she carries herself with that bashful sweetness and all that. She's a Rajalakshmi. Our queen is very good too. But we can say other people in the same family are funny. They belong to royal family, they have got that strength of character to belong to that. They have all the privileges, but they think they have all the rights, but no duty. And as that, also the Rajalakshmi can be very funny, like in this country there has been curses because of 7 queens were murdered in this country. I mean, can't think of any country where even one queen can be murdered by the queen. This country has a very funny curse of these 7 women who were killed like this. I mean, what sort of women they must have been, what sort of kings they must have been. I mean, this is so nothing of a Rajalakshmi. A Rajalakshmi is a dignified woman. She is the one who is the glory of the country. She has to be a glorious woman. She has to be a woman with all the attributes of a queen. And that is the Rajalakshmi, is the queen or the goddess, that is the queen. And she resides in every country. Every country has a Grahalakshmi. And if that is insulted, then the people suffer. They will suffer in so many ways, like they will have money problems, they'll have financial problems, they'll have also problems of society, all kinds, because whatever the queen does, whatever the king does, it is done by others, but especially the queen. Most of the fashions, say, in England have come because the queen started. So whatever she does, she's so important. And she has to have that idea in her that she is the goddess. She has to represent that goddess which decides in every country. So that is the Rajalakshmi. Now in countries where there is no, say, democratic countries there, all right, then the head of the first lady of the country should behave not like American lady who married a tycoon somewhere, an old man, and is now a photographer. And what is this? So cheap, it is so cheap. She doesn't deserve to be there. There's no dignity about her. She's competing herself with cheap street women. She should know that she is the first lady. In the countries where there is even, say, not democracy and other sorts of governments are there is also a first lady. And why now these first ladies also have become competitors, and they're competitor with their husbands and try, wherever they have tried such a trick. You see, even Mandar Naiki tried these things, she failed. Anywhere they tried like to outwit their husbands by this, they will fail. Because God is not with them. They are there because they are first ladies, and they should take all pride within themselves. Even if they feel they are a little bit let down by people not respected. But if she respects herself, nobody can be disrespected. She should keep her respect and everybody will respect her. But just to punish people if she has to behave like this, that means she has no value of her. So the first thing that one Lakshmi gives you is a value system. Your value system is correct. You evaluate yourself properly. Like you know the value of this and value of that and value of this. But the value system for a divine person is not based on the amount of money or amount of matter it has, but it depends on what vibration. So the whole evaluation system changes when you get into divine temperament, that you start seeing things, what is precious is what has the maximum vibration. Whatever has vibration is the precious thing for a realized, and not what is not divine. What is not divine, we have nothing. But you will be amazed, whatever is divine is all very precious also otherwise. Like the paintings which are done with divinity, means the realized souls have done, are today very expensive. May not be those days, but now today. Actually all that truth comes up gradually, and people can see that clearly, that there is something special about these things. So your value system changes. As your Mahalakshmi essence starts growing and manifesting, you stand absolutely open, and you find that new things, new ideas and new valuation of everything starts. Once this happens to you, know that you are growing. You must know how to judge whether you are growing or not. And that is how you will know that you are growing in the right direction, if your value system is improved. Today's day is this Lakshmi's day. I bless you with all the Lakshmi's powers, and especially the discretion improve your values. What are more valuable is to you? What is the most valuable thing to you? You must try to devise that. Then there is, after this day, when they worship, the first day is, they say that that is the day when Diwali was celebrated, when Rama was made the king. He killed Ravana on the Shera, and on this day that Rama was crowned, and that's why they celebrate it. Now Rama is the person at that time when he is crowned. He represents the benevolent king, and the benevolence of a king is being crowned. So that's why they celebrate Diwali. But we have a special significance of Diwali. It's very special significance, I think, that the light that we see here, you will see, always goes upward. Fire is element that always goes upward. It's always against the gravity, and it is against all that puts you down. And the light of the spirit is also like that. It always takes you upward. And the person who is a realized soul is called an enlightened person, because he has a light. And the light has a capacity to give you a full idea, to see what is what, to relate to each other, to find out the distances and the differences, and to discriminate. So the light represents discrimination. And when you are enlightened, the spirit is enlightened. In the sense, spirit is the light, but which starts expressing itself in the atmosphere, manifesting in the attention of it. Now, what we have done in Sahaja Yoga is nothing but this is Diwali. First, one light was enlightened. Then that light enlightened another light. And now we have so many lights. This is the Diwali that I have. I enjoy this Diwali than anything else. Now, some lights are really sometimes flickering. I know that. Doesn't matter. Some lights are afraid of the winds that might affect it. So I have to look after them. In India, you see, this part is called as Aanchal of the Mother. You see, where she keeps her child hidden. And this is where she looks after the candle also, the light which she has kindled. And very carefully she looks after it and tries to see again and again if it is burning or not. And then she is sure that it is burning nicely. Then she puts it on a higher place where it burns, not for itself but for others. It enlightens others and enlightens the path of the people who are going in the darkness. So for us, Sahaja Yoga today is a Mahayoga because it is a Deepavali. It's not only one Deepa of your mother burning, but it's so many lights all over the world. You know, they have taken their lights and their burning. Even small children are giving realization. It has spread to the villages now, and it's spreading slowly as the Diwali. And every day we celebrate Diwali, we have more and more lights, and I'm sure these lights are going to come. Those people who still have flickering lights have problems. They always have problems. And they must know that their light is to be brought in properly, into proper shape. They must put all attention to put their lights in order. If your lights are ordered, there cannot be a problem. There cannot be a problem. So the correction is also a divine quality in you. We should work inward by which you correct yourself. The other day I was explaining how you don't have to think. It's very simple. It's a machinery which is a divine machinery which you have found out now within yourself. Now, at this time when you have got a machinery, you don't have to think about it. Because the machinery that is divine is just like any other machinery. For example, you know the machinery of the car. You don't have to think. You don't think I have to put a brake, you just put it. When you are a master driver, you just do it. You don't think. Do you think? If you start thinking, you'll kill so many people by that thinking. So in the same way, if you have mastered this machinery, if you know which one to move, how to work it out, if you have mastered it, you don't think about it. You just work. And that is what it is. We have to understand that after developing Mahalakshmi Tattva, which is the main tattva, which is the evolutionary principle by which you have evolved, is the ultimate, the Sushumna, the central part, which is the most important. If the Sushumna is not all right, then you cannot do anything, because there is the flow. There is the opening, which is important, which makes you wider, which makes you deeper, which makes you great. That is the path of Sushumna, which must be always kept open. Must try to keep it open by balancing yourself, by this generous attitude, and by seeing everything in your through your discretion. Keep it open. Keep your Sushumna open. And that is the path of Mahalakshmi. If you keep your Sushumna open, there will be no physical problem, no emotional problem, and of course no spiritual problem. That is how one has to understand today's Mahalakshmi Tattva. Now at this position when you reach, you see, this position is very important at Mahalakshmi principle, that it gives you the witness state, no doubt. But as I have told you before, just after this first day's puja of the Lakshmi, when Rama was crowned, next day they have the second day. And on this second day, this is the 13th day, as I told you, is the day when the Lakshmi was born. 14th day is a horrible thing which I do not want to tell you much about, because that is the day the goddess had to fight all the horrible Rakshasa. So I don't want to talk about it much, because you know all that. That is the 14th day. Then the 15th day is the day when the moon is absolutely missing from the moon. It's absolute darkness, where you put these lights to suggest that there are lights, now let Lakshmi come within us. So there is no spot that should be left which is dark, so everywhere the Lakshmi resides and give us the glory of her blessing. Then this is the night when you have the dark night, as you call it, Amavasya. Then the first night after that is the first moon that the, you say the, what the baby moon? New moon. The new moon comes up, the first day, is the day when the new year starts for Shalivahana. As you know, Shalivahanas are my ancestors, or whatever you call it, the Sin dynasty. That is the day. That day they take a shawl of the mother, like this, and put this water carrier on top to suggest the Aquarius start. The Aquarius time has started. According to them, they put that on top of that and put it like a flag on top of their houses. Suggest now the Aquarius time is there. With the mother shawl, they make the flag, and on top of the flag is this the water carrier is put upside down to suggest that the Aquarius time has started, that the time of Kundalini has started, and that this awakening has to take. That's the first day of the year they start. Then after that, the second day is, so it is 5 days actually, but why I said 4 days celebration, because 1 day is a horrid day in between. But also there's a celebration, because after killing all these Rakshasas, there was Diwali. Many a time these things happened, and every time she killed all these Rakshasas, they celebrated it by putting lights all around. So after that is the second day, is very important, which is here, is the brother and sister special day, where the sister invites the brother to her house for food. And she, if he's a small boy, she'll give him a bath. Even if he's a big boy, he sits with all his clothes on and she puts water on him and puts something very fragrant things on his body and gives him a bath nicely and gives him a protection. It's the purity of relationship between a sister and a brother. And then the brother gives her something as a present at that time. He may give anything. It's just symbolic. It's the love and affection of a brother and sister is expressed at that time. It's very important. And then the sister, she actually gives him a bandhan with actual light, which is called as the aarti they do for the brother. And that's how they try to give a big protection to them. So this is the day of the, they call it in Marathi, Bhav Dvij or Bhaiya Dvij, or that is the Dvitiya, the second day of the moon. That starts in India. Now it has a significance, because it is very important that our relationship as a brother and a sister must be strengthened, must be purified, must be looked after. In India, even if somebody calls you a sister, or a brother, then he's a sister and a brother. It's a very difficult situation. If somebody calls you a sister, then you have to accept that situation. And if you accept that situation, all your life you have to carry on that relationship of that nobility. Whether he may be your brother or not, doesn't matter. He may be your sister, she may be your sister or not, does not matter. But once you have said she's your sister, then all that purity is there, all her chastity is to be protected, and she's to be looked after. So this is how it is. These are the 5 days they celebrate. In short, I've told you how we Sahaja Yogis should understand these 5 days are days of real festival for us, because we are overcome death now. We have overcome that degradation that would have followed after this. Now we are people who are victorious. So this is to celebrate our victory over evil, our victory over our weaknesses, and our victory towards the goal of our achievement, that is full self-realization. And that's how it's a great day of celebration, And may God bless you all. And in this jubilation, I join you all. And I'm very happy that we are so many today in this country. And a day will come when our righteousness and our greatness will definitely enhance. The path of darkness with its light and improve the conditions to such an extent that people won't believe that they were living in this wretched world and today they are in such a place. They won't believe. It will happen. As it has happened within yourself, it will happen without. And that's what is the day I'm waiting for, when such things will happen. And all these things we are doing here, leading a very righteous and a good life now, with forgiveness for others and with all the generosity, it will become a universal theme for people. And when this will become a universal happening, and when people will universally accept Sahaja Yoga, then will be the real day of Diwali celebration. May God bless. So I must say, for Christmas I won't be here. I'll be in India. It's nice way, you know, because I'll escape all your presents. you gave me so many presents last time that it was too much for me. Of course, if you say that I gave you, because that's of course nothing great, because see, if you give to one person, which is too much to carry. You say you have to have a shipload. And if one person gives to so many, it's not such a difficult thing, is it? But if everybody gives to one person, it's too much. And if one person gives to many, it's very good, because the load is lessened on everyone and also shared, you see, of that one person. So my giving was a better thing than your giving to me, because I was really thinking of taking a ship, see, put all the nice presents you gave me. So, do you have any questions? So now, मेरे साथ आज हाथ ही तोड़ देते हो जाएगा. Just this is your ring. Who is this one? Okay? Yes, sir. What is this? Simon, come now. So, you see, today's puja is more sort of asking for the expansion of your sushumna, more that. So as it is, when we are doing this puja, first of all, you must develop a mood of forgiving others and forgiving yourself also. Just that mood, first of all. To improve your sushumna path to grow, first of all. So there's a mantra for that. Yadevi sarvabhute shama rupe nasosita. And shanti rupe. All these mantras you should say, all of you. If you say these mantras, one you can say and they can repeat you. And then that will definitely improve. These are all mantras for the sushumna. The Indians are that way very funny. I think you people don't have any machine, a grinding machine in the thing. So I better pay for that machine. Because I would like to give some present to the ashram. And What do you call that machine? Grinding kabuto?
Grinder.
Become something greater and higher. That's the point.